We are right at 2 o'clock, so we're going to get started. Dr. Brannon Traxler is going to be providing today's update. Would like to welcome everyone to the DHEC June 16th media briefing on COVID-19. Again, Dr. Brannon Traxler, our public health director, will be providing today's update. And as always, we'll take questions that members of the media have submitted ahead of time, and then we'll turn it over for live Q&A. So before we begin, I'll be mindful to check folks that might be hopping on a little bit late today, but please remain muted so that everyone can hear Dr. Traxler's important update. So at this time, Dr. Traxler, take it away.
Thanks, Christy. There we go. I was trying to mute my own watch. So good afternoon, everyone. I want to start today's briefing by talking some about the COVID-19 Delta variant. Since the last briefing that we held, we've gotten several queries about this variant. And of course, we also saw yesterday, as I'm sure many, if not all of you did, that the CDC just classified Delta as a variant of concern. They have classified it as this because they've determined that it's about 40% more transmissible, more easily spread than the original COVID-19 strain. The variant, the Delta variant, also doubles the risk of hospitalizations, and that's due to an increase in the health complications that it causes. As of today, we have seen 4 confirmed cases of the Delta variant in South Carolina. These cases were discovered in the Midlands, PD, and Lowcountry regions of the state. As we learn more about Delta and the other variants that have emerged and are emerging, it becomes even more clear to us that vaccination is the number one way to end this pandemic and protect ourselves from illness and death. Public Health England, which is the closest thing England has to similar to our CDC, released a data analysis a couple of days ago that shows that being fully vaccinated with the Pfizer BioNTech vaccine is 96% effective against hospitalization, i.e. Severe disease due to the Delta variant. This is why we continue encouraging vaccinations through all of our various events and projects. Our Shot with the Chaser campaign, for example, has gotten off to a great start. And the same goes for our COVID-19 Vaccine Action Week that began on this past Sunday and will run through the end of this week. So it's ongoing this week. All of these efforts are even more important as we head further into the summer. We realistically could see a surge in cases after that July 4th holiday due to vacations, events, and other activities that involve larger groups of unvaccinated people. An uptick in cases is simply not the direction we need to be going as we work to get out of this pandemic. We need more people to roll up their sleeves and get their vaccines so they can protect themselves, their friends, their family, and their neighbors. Thank you. Back to you, Christy.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Trucks. I was just trying to find my mute. All right, so our first submitted question, how close is the state to reaching COVID-19 herd immunity?
Okay, so estimates for herd immunity related to COVID-19 are that at least 70 to 80% of the population would need to have immunity to reach that point. That specific point at which this could occur is not definitively known for this novel virus because it is new and the herd immunity has not been reached before with it. In addition, the percentage of people with immunity at this time is not in the state is not definitively known, as the duration of immunity following natural infection is not precisely known. However, there's likely still quite a ways to go, considering that we're at 39.6%, I believe, of eligible South Carolinians who are fully vaccinated. So that would be still a considerable gap that would need to be protected. You know, some may be through natural immunity from infection, but many still need to get vaccinated.
And with the shot, with the Chaser campaign at breweries, a viewer wanted to know if they should be concerned about getting vaccinated at a bar, since they heard you're not supposed to drink alcohol before your vaccination.
So this should not be a concern with participating in the shot with a chaser campaign. These, I just want to emphasize, these are the same vaccines that are being administered, you know, in doctor's offices and pharmacies. And the people who are administering these shots are trained medical professionals. The breweries are offering a single beer or soda to those participating after they get their shot. So they get their free beverage after they've gotten their vaccine. And of course, DHEC very strongly encourages people to drink responsibly and follow all health and safety protocols and certainly the laws that are enforced by the local municipalities, and really respect the rules also outlined by each individual brewery.
What is your reaction to the news from Novavax regarding the efficacy of its vaccine and its plan to file for emergency use authorization? How much impact will there be having another vaccine available, particularly in light of the continued decline in demand?
Sure. Having another safe and effective vaccine available is yet another tool in our toolbox for fighting this battle against this pandemic. As we have seen before during the vaccination phase of the pandemic, supply of a vaccine can unexpectedly change without much notice at times, and having other options available is always a good thing.
Have there been any Memorial Day-related uptick in coronavirus cases?
So based on that 14-day incubation period for COVID-19, knowing that the median time is about 4 to 5 days from when you're exposed to the virus to developing symptoms, looking at that time frame, we have not seen an uptick in cases from the Memorial Day or that weekend's events. That's a great sign, but it doesn't mean that our continued rate of decline or decrease in cases hasn't been impacted by the holiday. And it shouldn't imply that we are out of the woods just quite yet. Historically, we have been seeing a decrease in cases going back to about mid-January. With some, bumps, I'd say, along the way. It may still be too early to tell if the Memorial Day and its weekend's events and additional gathering may slow somewhat our continued progress of that decrease and decline in cases in the state, rather than, maybe actually causing a bump or an increase in cases.
How many J&J doses are set to expire June 23rd in our state?
So since the FDA has given the six week shelf life addition, our Janssen vaccine expiration numbers begin with about 25 doses due to expire August 5th, and then 2,900 doses due to expire on August 7th. 2,100 doses on September 5th and 2,300 doses on September 15th.
Are you concerned about the Delta variant spread? Should unvaccinated residents be worried about the Delta variant?
So as the COVID-19 cases continue to get, some of them whole genome sequenced by the various laboratories in the country, it's expected that more cases will be reported with the various variant types based on those CDC variant classifications. Also, given that the Delta variant has proven to be more transmissible, spread more easily than prior strains, the spread of it could increase faster and or to a larger extent. DHEC has been monitoring the CDC guidance related to COVID-19 variants. In case this guidance were to prompt a change in public health recommendations. But at this time, the most important recommendation for controlling the spread of COVID-19 and its variants continues to be vaccination.
So Dr. Traxler, a viewer says her mother got the shot a month ago and was screened for COVID antibodies during an arthritis exam. None were found. She later had a mobile tester come and look for antibodies and T cells. Again, nothing was found. Should this woman be concerned the shot didn't work? And what should she do?
So in general, we don't offer medical advice to individual patients. You know, that said, just looking more generally and globally, we don't recommend testing for COVID-19 antibodies after vaccination. Most of these tests look for antibodies that show if you had a previous infection with COVID-19. Not necessarily the same ones that are may have been made by the vaccine. Some people who have immune system problems or are on medicines that suppress their immune system may not have as strong of an immune response to the vaccine, however. But there are studies going on right now to look at whether, you know, there's value in getting a third vaccine dose for those people with those conditions or on those medications. But we don't have the results from those studies yet to know if that's going to be a recommendation or not.
Thank you, Dr. Traxler. At this time, I'm going to give our media partners a heads up that we've got two more submitted questions that we're going to ask and answer. And so if reporters can start shooting up their virtual hands, when we finish this portion, I will start calling on you by name to ask your questions. So, Dr. Traxler, with fewer people wearing masks, local doctors in Charleston say that cold and flu cases are going up. What can you say about this and What can you say about this, and how can people tell the difference between cold, flu, and COVID-19?
Sure. So many of the symptoms of other, you know, URI or upper respiratory infection viruses, including those that cause the common cold and the flu, overlap with symptoms of COVID-19, and that's something that we've known and has been in existence, you know, even going back since the early days of this pandemic. And so that's why the recommendation continues to be that people with these symptoms really should be tested for COVID-19 to rule that out before they assume it's something such as a common cold or even the flu.
And how many cases of the Delta variant have been discovered in South Carolina?
So again, we've seen 4 confirmed cases of that Delta variant in the state, in the Midlands, PD, and Lowcountry regions.
All right. Well, thank you, Dr. Traxler. That was our last submitted question. So Lexi, you've got a question for our physician today?
Yeah, I sure do. We know that the state of emergency there in South Carolina has ended, and that is ending some benefits that came along with it. Just from a healthcare perspective, are there any concerns you may have when it comes to some people losing food benefits that were there due to the state of the emergency?
So I know that the DHEC is continuing to focus on food insecurities that were present prior to the pandemic and during the pandemic. And I know many of our partners are as well. We recognize that getting a healthy, nutritious diet is a key component of people's health and well-being. And we're gonna continue doing just like we were doing before and throughout the pandemic to work with all of our partners to make sure that healthy food is accessible to all South Carolinians.
Kaylin.
Hi, 2 questions. So you mentioned that the Pfizer brand is effective against the Delta variant. So if folks have got any others, should they be concerned?
So that is the Pfizer one is the one that the data has been analyzed for, the, you know, tens of thousands of doses administered in England, specifically where they have seen that variant, and they have analyzed the data related to then hospitalized cases, you know, from that variant. I think given that the others are very similar in the terms of, you know, how effective they are against the quote normal COVID-19 strain, I think that, you know, at this time, vaccination with any of the approved or authorized, I should say, COVID-19 vaccines could be, you know, is the way to go. Don't try to pick and choose unless it's based on age, which vaccine you're getting. Really try to get the soonest one you can get is the best one.
And then secondly, you mentioned that those J&J doses were set to expire. What happens next with those doses once they expire?
So they will not be expiring until August. And so we still have some time on those. And so we certainly intend to use them and to get them into people's arms and not have that issue. However, if we were to have any doses of really of any of the vaccines to expire, we would work with our federal partners to follow their guidance regarding, you know, the safe and disposal or storage, depending on the recommendations of those doses.
MK?
Hey, Dr. Traxler, can you contextualize for us how much sequencing has been done on this Delta variant? And given that it has been classified as a variant of concern, is that an argument, I guess, to increase sequencing, get a better idea of how quickly this is spreading here in the state?
So in terms of conceptualizing, you know, regarding this variant, how much sequencing, I mean, again, we've identified four confirmed cases through sequencing that our public health lab and many of our lab partners have done. We do not know the exact denominator to say how many, that is to say how many, you know, specimens have been sequenced total, because there are so many labs and so much sequencing being done at this point. Not only is our lab doing it, and you know, but as well, there are many labs throughout the state doing it. There are many labs nationally that are doing it on specimens from South Carolina, and certainly when they identify variants are reporting back to us. And so it is a little hard to put that, you know, into context for you just because there is a lot going on. But anytime that variants are being identified, it's a sign, you know, to scale up sequencing, which has already been going on and continues to go on. And as I said, it's being done at multiple different types of labs and locations on many specimens.
Danny Lynn?
With the Columbia, with the mall in Columbia, with that site closing down, is there any thought being given to opening another one in Columbia or even perhaps somewhere else in the state, like a mass center like you had that at the Columbia Mall?
Sure. So you're referring to the FEMA Community Vaccination Center there at Columbia Place Mall?
Yes.
Okay. So to my knowledge, we have not been, FEMA has not been discussing with us, you know, immediately standing up any similar type of clinic. You know, we continue to assess the need as well as ensuring that there's access to everyone who wants vaccine in the state. So I'm certainly not going to rule it out, because if we are seeing that the demand is there, you know, and that people, especially that it's, you know, we could put one in a location that would be good access to folks who want the vaccine. We're doing everything we can to eliminate any barriers. And so we would look to stand up some sort of mass clinic. But at this time, there's no concrete plans to do that I'm aware of.
Mike?
Thank you. I wanted to follow up on MK's question with the sequencing. We know that there's been four cases of Delta variant discovered in South Carolina, and we know there's been in the last month or so 384. I just used the dashboard on that. 384,000 tests. We don't have any estimate of how many of those 384,000 tests have been sequenced.
We really don't, because as I said, we are not getting necessarily all of the sequences that are normal, I guess you would say. Places are certainly reporting to us, all of the labs on both our lab and then the state's labs and then the national labs are all reporting to us any of variants that they're identifying. But we don't know, for example, a large scale lab, national lab, you know, how many they're sequencing that are not in a variant, to be able to have that an accurate denominator there.
Do we know how many variants period have been sequenced? Because I think you said that we do have, anytime a variant pops up, we do get that information, or a variant of concern, I would get.
Right, the variants of concern. And And I believe that is what is on our dashboard. Is that not right, Christy?
Would that be the serology one?
Pardon?
Which part of the dashboard would that be? Would that be antibody serology?
No, and maybe Christy can drop a link, but it would be the dash. We actually have a dashboard that is variants.
Yep.
That's looking at variants of concern. We'll get you that link.
Yeah, I'll drop it in the chat in a few moments, Mike. Lexi, you've got another question?
Yeah, I don't know if you're able to talk on this, but I thought I would ask since I have the opportunity. We've been following the new indie odor that's been coming from that facility for some time now. Is there any update on that or, you know, any advice that you can give, you know, our viewers on it?
So I would certainly leave any, you know, comments or update on that to the experts on our environmental side. We have certainly been following along with them, you know, in step and monitoring it, but I really would prefer to leave the comments and updates to those experts. So maybe Christy can work with them to get you some information.
Yeah, and Lexi, we do have a webpage that has the latest information on our website. So if you're not already following that, I want to encourage you to do so. But yeah, I'll certainly pass that on to the team for follow-up. Kaylin, you've got another question?
Yes, with fewer people seeking testing, is it a concern that you may have a bit less of an idea of the amount of community spread and things?
So we're certainly keeping an eye on that amount of testing because you're right. If it dropped too low, that would be a concern that maybe not enough testing was being performed to capture an accurate representation, you know, an accurate number of positive tests. However, you know, at this time, especially considering the number of positives that we're encountering, we do think that enough testing is going on, but that is certainly something that we continue to monitor, and we continue to encourage folks that, as I mentioned earlier, in response to one of the questions, you know, have been submitted beforehand, you know, if you have any symptoms, you know, testing is still easily accessible. You can still go to DHEC sites for free and get tested. Turnaround is still 24, 48 hours for that PCR testing. Please go get tested. Don't just assume that it's something else. If you have symptoms, it could be due to COVID-19.
So are there any other questions for Dr. Traxler today regarding our coronavirus response? Give it just a minute and see if any little hands go up. Going once, going twice.
Christy, I just want you to know that I think about you with the little virtual hands every time I'm on a meeting and go to raise it.
Thank you.
I think about these media briefings and you asking them to do that.
Thank you. It looks like Janelis, you've got a question?
Hi, yeah, it's Janelis. I just was hoping to get some clarity about the antibody testing. I think I kind of get what you were saying, Dr. Traxler, but I was hoping maybe you could dumb it down for me a little bit about why you don't necessarily recommend getting your antibodies tested.
Sure. So we know that vaccines cause really multiple different types of immunity. And I will not subject any of you all to a immunology lecture on the different types of immune systems and mechanisms that are in place, but multiple of them, suffice it to say, can be triggered by a vaccine. So you can get protection from more than just antibodies, and there's even more than one type of antibody. And so you can get multiple layers of protection from vaccines. So testing for one type of antibody may not represent whether you have immunity or not. Does that help?
Yes, that makes so much more sense. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Are there any other questions? Yes, Dana Lynn?
Yeah, on the antibodies. I mean, aren't all of the vaccines, unlike the flu vaccine, where the flu shot, you get a flu shot, you get a little taste of the flu is in the vaccination. But the COVID vaccines are not. They're the RMA. They're the RMA. And so it seems to me like there wouldn't be any sign of an antibody following a vaccination?
So you do likely develop some antibodies. You're correct in that the flu vaccine and the COVID-19 vaccines are different types. So the flu vaccines are where they basically take the virus and, you know, change it, alter it so that it can't, you know, infect you. It can't multiply and infect you. But your body is developing the immune response to the virus. The COVID-19 ones actually are a couple of different types, but the more common is the Pfizer and Moderna, which is that mRNA that you mentioned. And so that's actually putting a little piece of the genetic code for that virus inside of some lipids and packaging it and sending it in. And you can develop antibodies to the protein that little piece of mRNA can code for. But you also can develop other types of immunity too. There's cell-mediated immunity, which is based around your T cells, as well as, you know, your humoral immunity, which is the antibody-based immunity.
Thank you, Dr. The
immune system is really pretty impressive with everything it can do and all the complexities and different layers.
Anyone else have any final questions for Dr. Traxler today? Okay, doesn't look like it. So Dr. Traxler, I just want to thank you for your time. Want to thank the members of the media for joining us each Wednesday to learn the latest information about coronavirus here in South Carolina and keeping, you know, our friends and our neighbors and our loved ones up to date with the latest information. We will join you again next Wednesday, not Dr. Traxler, another physician. We'll join you next Wednesday at 2 p.m. Thanks, everyone. Stay safe.